Welcome to the totally awesome fishing show where we try and catch everything we can. Now recently I was over in Ireland doing a rock fishing film with Mike. Well, doing five rock fishing films actually. We weighed up what I was carrying. With camera equipment, 60 pounds of equipment. Now that can't be right. That cannot be right. I mean, that's just a grueling task of endurance. Anyway, I've got to think about things. I think, what's the easiest type of fishing you can do? Do you know what? You think it's hard? It's not really. It's trout fishing. All the equipment you need is just here on the table. A couple of rods. All I've got, 9'6" to 10' ones. Throwing about a 7 line, weight forward. One with a floating line. Another one. There. Nice lightweight reel. Intermediate line, which means I can, you know, fish it on the surface, just under the surface film. Some fly boxes down here. Got some nice fly boxes. And flip up landing net like this, just flips up, just like that. Extends as well, folds up, clips on the belt. Now what else is there to carry? Well, nothing really, because you know, you use one of these fly fishing waistcoats. Loads and loads of pockets in there, you can put all your rubbish you want and then you carry it. Anything else? Not really, is there? Hat if you want one for a long peak. And a must for trout fishing, a pair of polarizing glasses, prescription like mine or otherwise. Now, obviously, yes, we're going trout fishing. We're going to try mayfly fishing, which is probably, I would guess, about the most famous British trout fly in history. Everybody must have heard who goes fly fishing, the mayfly. They usually last 2 or 3 weeks, no longer. Once a year, the trout go cuckoo on them, hopefully, each year for a very short space of time. I think that's actually getting a little bit closer each time, shorter and shorter the actual feeding periods that the trout go on them. I think the hatches are getting tougher and tougher. Let's just run through it if you want to go fishing for trout with the mayfly. Now these are the boxes you'd have for dry flies. You can fish nymphs or you can fish dry fly. Now the nymph basically fishes underneath the surface, just so if there's beginners out there and get yourself a fly box, they're not very expensive. Get yourself a needle or a pin to clear the eyes, you know, when you get some varnish in them. This has got a bit of everything in there, these. And you've got a flat foam one there if you've got ridge. Now, if you've got flies with hackles and stuff like that, you don't want to get them crushed, put them in the ones with the ridge so that it, you know, it just keeps actual feathers and fly tying materials a little bit, well, less crushed, basically. That's what I'm trying to say. Now, the mayfly nymph, very, very famous. Here is the traditional mayfly nymph, if you can see that there. It's got those distinctive ridges on it on the back and a sort of thorax head at the top. Now, I call this pattern, as far as I can remember, that's the traditional Richard Walker mayfly nymph, which is a very, very popular pattern 40, 50 years ago. And when I used to do fly tying myself, I tie up... Here are we, my own patterns of them, and they're all slightly a bit different. There we go, there's one. Put a bit of sparkle in that one. So I've got the same ribbing across the back, but I put a little bit of sparkle in it to try and turn the trout on. That's my own ones. I also used to tie them very, very dark as well. Real black things, animal things there. So you can use virtually any tan coloured fly in the nymph shape for fishing under the water. Then, if you want to go dry fly fishing, because basically it hatches out, the mayfly larva hatches out, lives on the bottom, hatches out, struggles up to the surface, and then hatches out, flies away, lasts maybe a day, 2 days, maybe even hours, mates, comes back to the water, lays his eggs on the water, they go down to the bottom to mate next year's larva, these flies die and lay on the surface. When they die and lay on the surface, they're called a spent fly, just laying flat. Now, these are nymphs, obviously. That's when you need to get a pattern of a dry fly. And I've got dry fly boxes. These are old-fashioned ones. One's quite a modern one. This is an antique one there, just to show you. That's a very, very, very old one. So take your flies out. They don't get crushed. See, the idea is that they don't get crushed in these little compartments with a little spring on the front. You can also put the ones you're using during that day here. And there we go. I've been used since last year, probably. That's a dry mayfly that has very, very bushy hackle and a long tail to support it on the surface. And this one, has a multitude of flies in there, far too many, a collection I wouldn't want to repurchase at today's prices. Now just down here, just so you can see, those are what I would call spent patterns. This thing is just an animal on the machine, this one, that somebody gave me as a mayfly pattern. Now you can see possibly there by the tail of that and the ribbing on there, and the fact that the wings are tied flat, it sits flat on the surface like that. It's absolutely flat on the surface. So that's a spent mayfly. It's laid its eggs, it's died, fluttered down, died, and that's when the trout generally gorge themselves on them. However, they can gorge themselves on the nymphs rising to the surface and emerging, and they tie what they call emerger patterns as well. But if you get yourself, if you're going to do this dry fly fishing, I've got far too many flies in here really, more than I'm ever going to catch trout. Get the ones where they've got these little folding compartments, which you just release by a spring there. Just like this, they pop up. Neat, just sort of gentle on it, like bang, 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 bang. And they're inside there. You keep all your nice dry flies, all the hackles and the tail, and any wings you might tie on there. They all stay nice. That's another, I'll call that another spent pattern there. Slight colour variations. And you can, you know, use what you want. Tie your own flies, buy them from the shops. And you can even get some, I'll just show you these, put these away. Like these, which are like a mayfly with polystyrene balls on the end to make sure they float. I personally haven't really caught a lot on these, are like the traditional ones. So you need nothing other than a few mayfly nymphs like these and a few mayfly dries. I don't know. Three of each, I would say it's all you need. One little tip I would give you, the modern tying here on these and the mayfly can have a bead head to it on the front. I don't know whether you're going to see that in the light. There was a little gold head there, a bead. That's good. Now that gets it down deeper, because don't forget these are coming up from the mud on the bottom. So if you want to fish deeper early in the morning when they're coming up, I would recommend using one of these. As the afternoon goes on, you can go to a standard pattern one, which doesn't have the gold head on, so therefore will ride higher in the water. And then as you get even further up in the evening, when they start laying their eggs and they're dying, they're laying on, then you can go to the standard dries, either dry on the surface or the flat one with the spent wings. So three or four different patterns of mayfly. Let's get down there. All you need is your regular regulation tackle. You don't need anything else. I use 9-10 foot leader, 6 pound, that's what I'm using. And you grease it. You can put some grease or oil on the fly. You want them to float. If you're going dry fly fishing, you want them floating on the surface with the leader. I've got some really old stuff here. I've had it since I was about 14 years old and it's still going. Just regular mucilin. She used to have a little pad there, and I put some on my finger, or a little cotton bud, and you rub that up and down the leader. That makes the leader float. Old school, old school. Modern, you can get dry fly gels that you can take out, and they're just, you squeeze it on and you rub the fly between your fingers, all over the hackles, all over the tail and the body. Just let it air dry for about a minute. That makes that dry. And you can also get, you know, just, well, it's called fly floating, you know. I'm not going to squeeze it, it's about to go in my eyes now, in my luck. Totally also all over the face. At least I won't drown, will I? But you can get fly line floating as well. Just spray the fly itself, and it makes, you know, fluff it all up with your fingers, let it dry, and then when it's air dried, where you go, you can fish right on the surface. For the nymphs, obviously I would start fishing the nymphs first in the daytime. Degrease with a degreasant. I use washing up liquid, really complicated. Degrease the leader, the nymph will sink deeper down through the surface film, you fish it up, and that's why I take the second rod, so I've got one for nymph fishing. It's quite difficult to strip off everything if you're, say, dry fly fishing. You go, oh God, I've got to strip it all off now, clean it off with washing up liquid to get it down, and you go, actually, they're coming up on the dry again, I want to be on the surface, I've got to grease it all up again. So I keep one for grease leader dry fly fishing, one for sunk nymph fishing with a degrease leader. That's it. All we need to do, as they say, is add water. Let's trundle off to one of the fisheries and see what we can do. I've heard the mayfly are in. It's cold wind. It's not been a good summer, has it, really? Let's see if we can't catch something, though. Now here at the lakes is catch and release. So I'm going to get one quick lift if I do get something, show you the fish. Fingers crossed, at least you'll get to see something. And, well, get one on the mayfly and then for one on the dry fly, I'll be a happy bunny. Let's go.
great British mayfly is synonymous with balmy summer evenings with barely a zephyr of wind. Well, it was when I was a youngster, but now global warming and the resultant weather changes has caused more wind, cooler air, and lower water temperatures. All these contrive together to put pressure on any fly hatch, and even on this session, there was a cool easterly breeze taking the edge right off the temperatures. After I set up all the camera angles, I could concentrate on the trout, but I was still confident something would happen. And happen it did.
Well, that's not often you get to see fish hooked up first class. There's not many waters like that. But this is it, they're looking for those mayflies. Even though it's bright here, it's not a monster fish, is it? Well, okay, I said it wasn't a monster fish, maybe it is. But it just goes to show you, be prepared. Get that nymph in the water, tweak it back, bang, hook up. Mayfly nymphs, albeit this is not the traditional Walker's mayfly nymph, this one is got a gold head, like a bead head on it, and takes it down. So I'd say it's not sort of traditionally a mayfly nymph, but it gets down to where those fish are, to where those nymphs are struggling up. That's the theory anyway. I don't like to play these fish too long. I like to play them a little bit harder. Catch and release, you want to get them in the net, show them to the camera if you have to. Better still unhook them in the net, and then let them go. It's a beauty, this little flip up net, so just flip and lock. And then you think, how do I extend it? A bit difficult, but it does work. Come on, bud, come on, come on. It's gonna be just a quick show for you, just to show it works. There it comes.
This rainbow had just nipped at the mayfly nymph, but that's all I need, one nip.
Oh, just tell me, that is not a prime example of a lovely rainbow trout. Beautiful condition, pretty little dots all over it. I'm going to get it straight back in the water. I feel there's more coming. And I want to search out over there where that scum is on the water, because I think that's where some of the mayflies are, and maybe a bigger rainbow. Right, people, I just saw that trout rise in there, right in here, right under the bushes. And maybe it's mayflies coming off of these trees, they're just up there and they're coming back down to drop their eggs in there. I don't know, might be one that's taken off, might be one that's spent. But that trout definitely took under the bush. And don't be afraid to get in these gaps and ping it out. Now, you can't do this with dry fly fishing, but you can do it with a weighted nymph. You can use what we call a catapult cast and ping out there. I just turned off it. That shows you that catapult cast can actually work. I think I'll back out of here. It's like the Amazon jungle. But if that's where the trout are, I'll get in there with them.
Don't stay in the one place. Keep walking slowly around, trying to spot either individual trout, rising fish, or somewhere the mayflies have drifted to. Look under overhangs, bushes, trees, or by weed beds. These are all features that could hold a trout. It might not be traditional open water tactics, but I always say, there's casting, but there's catching. I know which one I want.
Now then, the reason I'm creeping around is because I don't think trout like physical movement close up like that. And the reason I'm wearing my bright gold polo shirt is because I don't think they can see colour. And I've just proved that by catching that trout. And And here comes the plane spotter. Obviously, the fisheries inspector has seen I'm wearing a yellow jumper and is probably banned.
This swim has no space for backcasting at all. It's a jungle out there. But I can still work a line out steadily by using an extending roll cast. If you get it right, your fly should be out far enough to reach a trout. Basically, it lets me fish an area that no other angler might have thought of trying. And it's this tiny edge that enables me to winkle out those extra hard trout. I always reckon if I can get my fly out there, I'm always in with a chance. And I only need one chance to nail a fish.
Okay, well, I spotted one. I've seen two actually, but I've seen one much bigger fish, much bigger fish. So always do this as a tip. If you're going for a bigger fish, make sure from your previous trip that your spool is not all knotted down in there. You want one overlapped loop of line in there that comes up tight like this. Pop, it's all over and done. So I'm going to strip some out. Hopefully the big fish won't take it that much if I get him. And then I just lay it on nice and even. Side to side, just go across the spool side to side like that. Then when you do hook a big fish, you know, once you clear that initial line on the ground, you're in with a fighting chance. And this one I've seen is a good fish. Might take me a while to find it, but I'm going to have a look, and that's why I've got the polarizing glasses. Bright sunny day, should be able to see the fish. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to put another camera in my mouth. Yes, because I forgot the head cam, so I'm going to try and get you the actual hookup with the camera in my mouth. If I strike too hard, I'll swallow the camera and you'll see my insides instead. Now, there may be those among you that think this man's mouth is so large it could take a full-size Nikon 2¼ square. You may well be right, but if this comes off, at least you might get a bit of an action. I've got a case here and I can't quite get my mouth in it. I've tried. It won't go in. So what I'm going to do, I've tied a piece of fishing line around the back of the casing. I'm going to hold it like this on my teeth. I'm going to try and cast and hope you see the take and the hook up at the same time. Man, here at Totally Awesome Fishing Show, we do some stupid things. Nearly. There's an outflow pipe here, I've got to be real careful with this outflow pipe. Tell you what, he's bigger than I thought. He's right by the pipe. Right by the pipe. Oh, he's going for the pipe. He's going for the pipe. Oh, he's going for the bushes. Come on. We're nearly there. Maybe it's my shot. There's my shot. Come on. I'll bring the camera up so you can have a look at this one. There we go. Hook's out. There is that mayfly nymph. A bit chewed and bedraggled, and it's going to be real quick because this is a big fish. Oh, come on, man. I got the net up. Very quick, very quick. About 8 pounds of absolutely stupendous rainbow trout. That is, my God, that's as big as I've caught on a mayfly nymph. What a crackerjack fish. I tell you, I was pleased with that fish. Now I'm going to take a walk along the other end here, and this is what I want to tell you about this scum floating on the surface. It's all like catkins that have come down, but if that's drifted here, then obviously any fly lice should have drifted here as well. And it's right in there. If I can point it out, all this scum here, trout going to come down the inside here feeding over by that tree. In fact, I can see a movement, a bit of a ripple over under there, right hand side of that. And I'm going to have one more go with the nymph here. Obviously, painting the obvious, they're nailing these mayfly nymphs. I think a lot of its depth. Later on this evening, they'll probably come up in the water. You'll be able to pick them off near the surface. I'm going to get one more hook up on a nymph for you. Hopefully, he says, arrogantly. It normally means a blank or a hook up the tree or something. Give it one more shot across that scum, but I'm going to have to strip it through the scum because I can't actually individually see the fish there. I can't spot anything. Give it a shot and then, yes, I'm going to try and get one on the dry. To make life a little bit more interesting, as soon as I make the cast, I'm coming right to the camera and see if we can't get the tape for you. Here we go, here we go. Let it sink. Let it sink. Right, now we're going to start tweaking. Come on, trout. I know you're in there somewhere. In amongst that scum. Whack-a-doo. Oh, he's come off. Really tight cast in here. Got a tree right behind me. It's sort of back cast. Punch it out. Let's try that side. That's better. Of course, you've got that bead head on there. Also punches through the surface film. And also gives you the weight to get, hopefully, down through the scum. Here we go. No pulls, no takes, no flashes. I see nothing. Well, there's a second patch of scum drifting over to the right. I think I'm going to make a cast in there. Right, let's try that side straight out. Switch a camera position. Okay, I've thrown it up further on the edge of the scum. Maybe they're just on the edge. You know, I thought they'd be right in amongst the scum, but they might just actually be right. Oh, there he is. Oh, I thought they were in the scum, and they're not. Get some line on. Get some line on. Strip first. Wow, look at that fish go. Look at that fish go. Spin it, spin it, spin it, spin it. Okay, we're on. Let's get round the other side, folks. Should be able to see a bit better there now. It's not a big fish, this one. It almost took the fly line out of my hand. At least you can see him. Hope. Whoa, he's a scrapper. I've got a huge tangle, looks like in my leader. Got a wind knot where I clipped the three on the back cast. I said he's small. He's not that small. Come on, baby. Come to totally awesome. It's so handy, these little folding nets. Come on, fish. Oh, didn't like that extra pressure, did he? Did not like that extra pressure. Oh, he's coming around the side. Come on, come on, come on. Slowly, slowly. This is one feisty trout. He is totally toast. That's going up quickly for you. Here we come. Here he comes. Up for the camera. Beautiful fish. So you can see mayfly nymphs work. Get out there, guys, and let's see if we can get one on the dry. And now you can see all those catkins coming down in the wind. They're actually blowing straight onto the surface of the water, drifting down in the corner. And this is where any insects are going to go. And this is where I should be looking for a rainbow trout on a dry mayfly. I've just heard one tape. I just literally heard one tape. Where to put the car? I kind of like it slicked off, to be honest, because it gives me a chance actually, after the fish rises and goes down, I can usually see which direction he's taken and put the fly in front of him again. Now, another way that I have seen used is actually twitching the mayfly along the surface. I saw an American guy do this, a place called Leominster Fishery down in the New Forest in Hampshire. That's England. It's a coloured water. People were struggling. There's a little floating island. And I'll never forget, it's like 30 years ago, more than that, 35 years ago, this guy, I think he had a Lee Wolf pattern, and he was just dragging it across the surface, and he was on his second ticket, which is 8 big rainbows. So, you've got to learn. I've not tried it more than a few times with limited success. But with all these catkins here, it seems to be bringing them up as well. Maybe the catkins look like a big mayfly or something, I don't know. Let's give it a shot.
At last, in the lowering rays of the late afternoon sunshine, the mayfly started their ritual dance. It happens just a couple of weeks every year, around the end of May and into early June, and it's still a sight to behold. The light was just right for my camera, and by luck, I could film their tumbling dance before they returned to the water to lay those eggs and die. A sad, brief life in the air, but if it meant good trout fishing, hey, do I care? I went back to the lakes and could see the trout taking the spent mayfly off the surface. Now I was really in with a chance of catching one on a dry fly. The dancing mayfly were like fragile butterflies in the shafts of sunlight. But once they returned to the water, the trout and other fish were lying in wait for them. It was to be a brief fishy banquet for any fish in those lakes.
There we go, that is a mayfly, and that's in that corner where the scum was drifting, and as you can see, that was a spent one that's just laying on the surface, and he drifted in amongst all the catkins and scum. So I was right. If you can fish downwind, find out where these flies are drifting to, and when you want to fish dry flies on the top, he's still alive, this little kitty, that's the place to go. Think wind, where's it pushing all the food to?
On the other lakes, another fly fisherman was also staying on in the evening, and his rod bend showed the trout were feeding here too. The mayfly hatch is like the flick of a switch. One minute nothing, the next trout are gorging on the insects, throwing all caution to the wind. It's exactly the same on rivers, where the mayfly hatch might even be shorter, barely an hour or so at dusk. I've fished the famous River Test and found sometimes they only rose in that gloom before dark. One of the most famous sayings is, be there when they bite. When the mayfly hatch is on, even the wariest of brown trout can suddenly throw all caution to the wind with a sudden glut of flies. This is why the 2-week season was always called Duffer's Fortnight, when even the poorest of fly casters could catch a trout. Oh dear, with the mayfly hatch exploding in front of me, the pressure was really on. I don't want to be the only duffer not to catch one.
Okay people, here's my mayfly. It's all greased up ready. I can see a few trout moving there. right on the edge of the scum, twitching the dry, just like that American guy did, and it works. Oh, good fish too. As usual, yes, the net is miles away. Chihuahua, come on in. Come on in. Okay, I'll take this one. First shot I get, I'm going to take it. Got it. Siree, rainbow trout on the dry mayfly, water everywhere, all over me, all over the lens. Let's get this one on hook quickly. Those mayflies are coming off now. I think the hook's fallen out. Here it comes. Feast your eyes on that one. What a beautiful trout. Class fishing. Get it back in the water. I'm out of breath. What a session. Totally awesome fishing. Get out there until the next time. Tonight, the Mayfly rules.